कंप्यूटर
यस
द इलेक्ट्रॉनिक डिवाइस विद द हेल्प ऑफ वी कैन कैलकुलेट इजली कैलकुलेशन एंड वी कैन वर्क सो मेनी वर्क वाया एमएस वर्ड, एमएस एक्सेल, एमएस पावर पॉइंट। वी कैन इजली भी क्रिएट स्लाइड सो वाया।
So let's start with the very first unit of your syllabus, and that is about introduction to computers. Fine. So agenda of studying this unit is that is your first module is basic introduction to computers, definition of the computer, components of computer, various types of computer. Generally, we are confused about types, so it will be consisting of brief introduction to types as well as various generations of computer. So whenever you think about computer, what is the first word that comes to your mind? Let's do some brainstorming. I'm asking simply one word that come to your mind whenever you listen about the term computer. Any one word?
Technology.
Yes. Anyone else? Any other word? There may be a number of words that can come to your mind.
I'm repeat again question.
I'm simply asking, whenever you hear about the term computer, what is this one word that come to your mind? Any one word that come to your mind whenever you you want to talk about computer or you listen about the term computer, one word that come to your mind. I want one word from each one of you.
Ma'am,
One word.
a computer is an electronic device operating
One
under
word, one word. I'm not asking for definition. I'm asking for one word. Give me one word. Any one word that come to your mind. Someone may
ma'am.
think about program,
Yes,
software,
ma'am.
hardware,
Desktop,
a machine, electronics,
desktop, desktop.
automation. So I'm asking for one word only. A number, if you are having n number of students in class, then there n number of words can come that can make a definition for a computer. We need not to go for any technical definition. Simply if we keep on collaborating all the words that come to your mind, it will itself make a definition. So generally we say the computer looks like this, but there are a number of ways in which a computer look like. A mobile is also a computer. If you are having a smartphone device, that is also a computer. Simply, if we want to define the term computer, then we simply say it may be a workstation, it may be a mobile, it may be anything, it may be a small automated machine, that is also a computer. If we're talking about any smart LED, that is also a computer. But the only thing is a computer, simple in simple terms, we can define. It takes input from the user, do the processing for that that input, and produces the output. If there is anything that is performing these three tasks, then that is a computer. Input, process, output. So these are the three major categories when we want to define the term computer. So have a look at this diagram. What is it saying? It's saying we are processing the data. See, here it says, firstly, there is a data, that is input. That's what I'm saying. So you just input the data, and that input data is being processed. Generally, this process is done by CPU, Central Processing Unit. This is the device that is performing this type of processing. And finally, it produces information. There is basically a difference between data and information. Can anybody tell me about the difference between data and information? Yes, anyone wants to participate? The difference between data and information? Okay, let me tell you. Now suppose I am writing a word on the screen. Just have a look at this. What is this word? What I have written? Here, See, well, I have written something over here in the topmost corner. But I have written.
Ma'am, I want to explain what is the difference.
Just tell me what I have written. I don't want any explanation that can be taken later on. Just tell me what I have written.
Ma'am, difference between data and information.
I have not written anywhere difference between data and information.
Ma'am, you tell me anyone want to explain.
Yes, data. Monica has given the right answer. Monica has rightly cracked what I want to say. I have just asked what I have written. Monica replied 30. Thank you, Monica, for your participation. So it is 30. And now my question is, what is this 30? Can anyone tell me what is this 30? Suppose I have written 30 somewhere, or I simply speak 30, then can you tell me what that 30 is? Nobody can say what is this 30. It may be age of something, it may be weight of something, it may be a date. Suppose it may be 30th June, 30th May, it may be anything. We can also say this is the weight of something, some device. You can also say this is height. It can't be height, but it can be height in centimeters also. But it can be, you can say age, it can be weight, it can be anything. So until and unless we don't know what is it, then we call it a data. Okay? So in simple terms, until we know what is this something is, that is simply raw material, that is known as data. Fine. Now suppose with this 30, I wrote here, I have written age is equal to 30. Now this becomes information. Now you know what is this 30. Earlier it was simply a raw figure, so that was data. Now I have performed some processing. I have written age is equal to 30. Now this 30 becomes information. But until and unless you define certain meaning onto that thing, it will remain just a data. Fine. So what is computer doing? It takes raw data, perform processing on that data, and provides information. At the same time, it does very important task, that is storage. Until and unless the data is stored somewhere, then it is a big loss for us because we need to store the data. So whenever we are defining computers, we can define it this way. We say a computer is an electronic device. It is an electronics device because it is made up of lots of IC devices and many more things. So then we have, they are operating under a control of instructions. Under the thing or the device that is processing this thing is known as a software. We need a software that makes that device smart. Suppose you have bought a mobile phone or you have bought a smart TV. It will not be smart until and unless there is embedded software in that device. So once it is having a software, that electronic device will become a computer. Fine. Now suppose what is the difference between the earlier TVs, earlier televisions? They were just like electronic boxes. You can view pictures, images, videos, whatever you want to view on that. But now the smart LEDs, what are their difference? They are still electronic devices, but we have put some sensors, we have put some functionality processing that is putting some automation in that. So it's some software has been embedded into that, and that device has become a smart device. So like mobile phones, generally whenever we are talking about mobile phone, we say my mobile phone is having Android operating system. Someone will say my mobile phone is having iOS operating system. Fine. Some mobile phones are having Windows operating system. So the operating system is the software that will make that device smart. Until and unless in any electronic device an operating system is present, that device will remain an electronics device. But once we put intelligence in that device with the help of a software, that device will become a computer. So the major functionality of computer is it is an electronic device, all that is operating under the control of some instructions, and the data is stored in its memory unit. So data will be stored somewhere that can it will accept input, it will manipulate the data, that is it will process the data, and it will produce some information from the processing. So this is the full-fledged definition of the computer. You need not to go for other definition. This definition with this diagram is a complete definition. Fine, it consists of each and everything. So whenever if you are asked to give definition of computer, then this definition is self-explanatory with this diagram. Now next topic into your syllabus is features or characteristics of a modern computer. Features and characteristics are one and the same thing. So let us have a quick look at various characteristics. One of them is speed, accuracy, vigilance, reliability, versatility, storage capacity, automation, quick decision, power of remembering, no feeling, no IQ, multitasking. So let us have a look at these two first. No feeling. Computer is a machine, so it has no feeling. Fine. If we are talking about a robot, that robot may be working like a human being. It may be performing all that task, but still it is a computer. It is a machine. It will have no feeling. Fine. And next we have no IQ. A computer may be modern, it may be a modern up-to-dated computer system, it may be a supercomputer, but still it has no intelligence quotient. Computer works on the intelligent, with that intelligence only that is provided by you only. The programmer gives some instructions to the computer that is into their knowledge base, it will work on that only. So remember these two characteristics: no feeling, computer has no feeling, computer has no intelligent quotient. Okay, so it has no IQ, no feeling. Fine. So let us discuss all other characteristics one by one, because it is very important from your long answer type question point of view also. So first is speed. Is this diagram explaining you something? Can anyone tell me what does this diagram explains? Have a look at this diagram and tell me what is happening in this.
He works so fast.
Working fast is working at rocket speed?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it true? Is it true whatever I am saying? Is it the diagram is representing something? Is it true?
Yes, ma'am.
It is showing it is working at rocket speed.
Not at rocket speed, but it's fast, ma'am.
Yes, it is bit fast, but actually it is at rocket speed. I will tell you the name of a computer that is a supercomputer that works like a rocket speed. Okay, quickly tell me one thing. How many of you are working on your computers? How many of you have systems? It's very interesting question, guys. Just participate. I'm going to tell you something very interesting. Okay. Have you heard about the terms we say how many cores are there into your PC? If anybody is not having system, nothing to worry about. No worries. Don't bother about that. I will give you live demo of each and everything. We are given time of 1 hour only, but nothing to worry about. We may spend more than 1 hour also as per availability, but we will gain a lot of knowledge because only theoretical part is not always good. Am I right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now let me show you one thing. I'm opening something on my system. See, I have opened my system's configuration, a system on which I am working. Fine. So are you able to see here the processor?
Yes, ma'am.
It is mentioning Intel R Pentium CPU 630 2.70 gigahertz, 2GB RAM, 32-bit operating system. Okay? It is describing some of the properties. And whenever some of we are working on laptops, then on the laptop there is a sticker board which says quad core, 8-core. Is it mentioned there or not on your laptops, those who are having laptops? It is mentioned somewhere on the laptop. It is mentioning quad core. Is it there? Have you seen it? So that is basically the CPU processing configurations, quad core. That is about processor. Fine. That is about processor. How much cores our processor has? Most of you might have worked with the quad core processors. Fine, because this is commonly available these days. We say quad core. अगर मैं आपसे पूछूं कि मेरे को आंसर दो अबाउट योर कोर्स ऑफ योर पीसी, मैक्सिमम आंसर आई विल गेट क्वाड कोर. फाइन. एंड इफ आई टॉक अबाउट रैम, देन वी से आई एम हैविंग 4GB रैम, माय सिस्टम इज हैविंग 4GB रैम. एंड समवन विल से माय सिस्टम इज हैविंग 8GB रैम. फाइन. सो दीज आर द कॉमन अवेलेबिलिटीज ऑफ रैम दैट इज अफेक्टिंग द सिस्टम. वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द रैम इन डिटेल ऑल्सो. सो इफ आई हैव अ लुक एट दिस थिंग, I can see my processor is having this gigahertz speeds. It is having 2.0 gigabytes of RAM and it is a 32-bit operating system. Fine. Now let me show you one thing. One more thing I will show you. Yes.
Ma'am.
Yes.
Please tell me processor quad core, dual core, core T2, i3, i5, i7. Ma'am, what is different, ma'am?
We will discuss these things when these terms will come under the second unit.
Okay.
Fine, we will discuss all those things. But right now, I'm showing you one thing. I'm showing you this thing because we were having a look at this image which was saying this thing. Rocket speed. That's what I want to show here. That's why I stopped in between. See, I'm showing you one thing. I have written fastest supercomputer in the world. Fine. So this is the fastest supercomputer. Its name is Fugaku. F-U-G-A-K-U. Fugaku. This is the fastest supercomputer. This is again a technology from Japan. And this has been present in Germany also. Now, if I have a look at configuration of this, Fugaku configuration. I'm showing you because only then you will believe okay, what is happening in the world. See the configuration it is showing. It is saying memory 32 gigabytes. Okay? Storage done it is representing. Then it is representing its configuration. It is not having only this much speed. Have a look at this. Performance 442.
Gigabyte.
First it's this. Fine. And then this CPU A64FX. Then a number of other facilities. Linux-based operating system. I will show you one more data figure.
Ma'am.
Yes.
What is gigabyte?
Gigabytes are way of representing the memory. 1 bit is equal to, if I computer understands only the language of 0 and 1. Fine. So if I'm talking about 0 and 1 only, it means I am talking about 1 bit. 4 bits make then a byte. 8 bits make nibble. Then if I talking about gigabytes, it means hundreds and thousands, million, trillions of bytes. That is the way of representing the computer. So you can have a look at this. You can see how much power it is consuming, total number of nodes, total 430 racks are there. And this is the world's fastest computer, fastest supercomputer. This is the picture of this Fugaku system like this. This is the supercomputer. And you can find configuration of this. You can check the RAM available in Fukagu. RAM of Fukagu. See, this is giving its configuration of Fukagu supercomputer. It is world's fastest computer. You can search a lot in your free time on the Fukagu supercomputer. You can see top 500 organizations. It will give you a lot of information. Now see, but we were talking about quad core. This was a general term at which we all agreed. Okay, most of you have heard about the term quad core. Now see the cores available in your supercomputer Fukagu. How many cores are there? Just read this word. It is saying 763048. We can read it at 76,30,848. We were talking about our system is having quad core. We feel proud. My system is having quad core. How many cores? Quad cores mean four cores. And see how many cores are there in this supercomputer. It is saying 76,30,848 cores. And now have a look at the memory. We say my system is having 1 terabyte and we feel proud. And see, it is having RAM of 5087232. And this is the processor. So you can see this is the world's most powerful computer. This is the PAR. That is 29,899.23 kilobytes. This is the power consumption. So see how much power consumption it is taking. And it is based on Linux operating system. Linux is the most powerful operating system. And this is at world's rank 1. In November 2020, this supercomputer Fukagu took place of rank 1 in the world, being the most powerful computer. Fine? So if anyone asks you, you may be from management background, but you should know which is the fastest computer available in the world and which is the most powerful computer. So this is the most powerful computer, but is a supercomputer we will discuss today itself. So this was just a demo that I want to give you about the speed. So you can see this computer is working at the at rocket speed. So this is a true image. So it says a computer works with much higher speed and accuracy compared to humans while performing mathematical calculations. It can process millions of instructions per second. The time taken by computers for their operations is microseconds and nanoseconds. And next is accuracy. Whenever we are talking about accuracy, it means how correct we are. Generally, if I say perform an addition of 565,000 plus 78,000 plus 99,000 plus 9 billion plus 10 billion trillion, so on. You will say, I am very good at mathematics and I have provided this result. And at the same time, second person uses calculator. So whom should I believe? I will believe a calculator because that is more accurate than a human being. So same thing is happening over here. If we are performing any calculation, we believe on computers are more on calculation because they are more accurate. There are very less chances of errors in computers. So computer, what is the reason? Because computer never gets tired. Being a human being, we will get tired, but computer never get tired. So that is the point, accuracy. Computer performs calculation with 100% accuracy. Errors may occur due to data inconsistency. Errors will occur only in the case if you are providing wrong input. How computers are working? You provide some input, it will process and provide the information. Then the problem may occur only if you are providing wrong input. So if you are not providing any wrong input, it will work accurately. Fine. So this was about the accuracy. Next is DigiLens. This is the point. Whenever you are working, you get tired after some time. Suppose you are attending lectures since morning. You may have good energy level, but there will be a time when you will start feeling down. Fine, but a computer never gets tired. It can perform a million of tasks or calculation with same consistency. The computer may be performing at 9 a.m., it may be performing at 9 p.m., it may be performing at 11 p.m., but the consistency level will remain same. It will work consistently. So a computer can perform million of tasks or calculations with the same consistency and accuracy. It never feels fatigue or lack of concentration. Its memory also makes it superior to other human beings. Any idea you are getting with this diagram? Don't look at the point that is written over here. Just have a look at the diagram and tell me what is happening in this.
And it's the one time to get more information and work so many.
It is processing a lot of things. So many things are being processed at the same time. Like on my system, I have put a file on downloading. At the same time, I am uploading a file on YouTube. My Gmail is also open. My PPT is also open. I am doing a Google conference on my system. At the same time, a C++ or Java programming is also running on my system. So a number of tasks are being performed parallelly. That is known as multitasking. A computer is multitasking, and that multitasking is known as versatility. So versatility refers to the capability of computer to perform different kinds of work with same accuracy and efficiency. All the tasks are becoming perfectly. They all are being performed perfectly. That's why you are from management background, but in your syllabus, information technology is a mandatory syllabus. Why it is this? Why it is compulsory subject? The only reason is because you may be talented, but you at some time you may feel fatigue. Then computer will support you. It's because it is dizzy lens. It has the property of dizzy lens. At the same time, it can perform a number of tasks parallelly. It can support you. It will bring business intelligence, and that is the you may be working on data analytics, that is business analytics also. So if you want to bring business intelligence, that is you want to maximize the profit, then computer has certain algorithms of machine learning that are performing on data analytics, big data analytics that are being performed by data scientists. So data scientist is a field of computer science engineering, and that is supporting business persons. Computer professions will be providing you with certain softwares that will help you in making smart decisions in your business. That's where these type of subjects are there in your syllabus. Fine. So next is reliability. You can rely on a computer. Reliability of a system is very high because it is working with accuracy. So computer is reliable as it gives consistent result for similar set of data. If we give same set of input any number of times, we will get same result. But remember, your input should be correct. That's why when we were discussing about the definition of computer, we focused, it is having some input, it is providing some output, and it is processing something, it is storing the data. So you should be very much clear about what type of input you are giving to the system. If you are providing wrong input, You are wrong, because computer is reliable until and unless it is getting good input. If it is getting wrong input, then it will not work accurately. Next, we have automation. Computer can perform all the tasks automatically. That is, so it is working parallelly on a number of tasks. Automatically, it performs the task without manual intervention. So you can see from this diagram a number of tasks being performed. You can schedule a task that this should be performed at this time. Computer will start performing that task. So that is automation. Next is it is having memory. A number of memory devices are available that we again discuss in the new module. In a detailed part, so a computer has built-in memory called primary memory, where it stores the data, and it has having secondary memory. If you are talking about pen drive, CD, DVDs, floppy disk, they are your part of secondary memory devices that are used for storage purpose only. And primary memory is the memory that is RAM and ROM. Without RAM and ROM, your system will not work because it needs temporary memory available. Now, next, again, very important topic, that is classification of computers.
Ma'am,
how can Yes.
Please again explain primary memory and secondary memory.
I can take your queries later on. You can explain your queries later on. Let me complete. I will take your queries also. I will take your answers also. If you want to explain something, I will give you time after delivering my lecture. I will definitely give you time. Let me bind up with these three few terms. Fine. So classification of computer, whenever we are talking about classification of computer, so basically a computer is classified into three major categories. And have a look at these categories. What are these three categories? First is based on type. If we are talking about based on type, computer is of three types, that is the analog computer, digital computer and hybrid computer. We will discuss these three in detail. Based on purpose, computer is maybe general purpose computer. It may be a special purpose computer. From image, you can see general purpose computer is just simply PC. Special purpose computer, there is a computer that may be used for scanning purpose, like in medical laboratories. It may be used for your MRI machine. So that is a special purpose computer. And then scientist computers. So a number of devices, computers are available that are of special purpose computer. So if we talk one based on size, they are microcomputer, mini computer, mainframe computer, and supercomputer. Let us discuss all these in details. Firstly, we have a classification based on type and technology. So whenever we are talking about classification on computers, then we are having analog, digital and hybrid computers. So analog computers are having speedometer, thermometer, means electronic devices only. Digital computers are your desktop computers, personal computers, or your laptops. And hybrid computers means a combination of analog computer as well as your digital computer. So analog computer is basically analog from the word British, from the British English word. It is a form of computer that uses continuous physical phenomena such as electrical, mechanical, hydraulic qualities to model the problems that are being solved. And whenever we are talking about digital computer, here comes a term that we were talking about. Yes, Peta, I will be uploading the this recording also. I will be providing this PPT also. This PPT will be available under the lecture notes in your Google Classroom. And this recording will be available on my YouTube channel. I will share the link of my YouTube channel and the link of this video also. So, and everything will be available in that. You need not to worry. You will get all notes. You need not to go for any book reference or anything. You will get each and everything in my notes only. Fine. We will be covering each and everything in detail. So, an analog computer, we were discussing about gigabytes and all. So, here we are saying a computer that performs calculation and logical operation with quantities presented as digits. That is known as digital computer. So if we are talking about 0-1 language, that is digital computer. And if you are talking about a computer is understanding electronic, hydraulic, mechanical functions, that is an analog computer. And hybrid computer is a computer that consists of combination of analog as well as digital. So combination of computer that are capable of inputting and outputting in both digital and analog signals. A hybrid computer setup of cost-effective method for performing both type of task. So let us discuss about this special purpose and general purpose. There is these are simplest to understand. Whenever I am talking about general purpose computer, you can say your mobile phone, your tablet, your iPad, your laptop, your PC, your desktop computer, all are your general purpose computer because we are using them for our purpose only. Whatever we want to perform, we are performing on our computer. So that is general purpose computer that are used for general tasks. So we say use for general purpose like entertainment, word processing, internet surfing, calling, and these are basically less expensive. These are cheap and can perform variety of work. So best example is personal computer and your mobile phones. So special purpose computer, like suppose you are having metro system, fine. Traffic light system, ATM, then you can say airplane management, and then your medical devices, your MRI machine, your X-ray machine. So all those computers are generally designed for a particular specific purpose. So they are special purpose computers. If I talk about a smart LED, that is a special purpose computer, because from LED you are not going to make phone calls. On your LED, you are not going to do programming of C++. Fine. So that specifically the main purpose is, it is understanding your touch panel, your touch. It is providing smart decisions. It may be turning off automatically. There are a number of functions that are available with smart LEDs. So that are your special purpose computer. That are not general purpose computer. I am talking about a fully automatic machine. A fully automatic washing machine. That fully automatic washing machine is having a device that makes it take some water, take this much surf, wash the clothes, dry the clothes, and the task is over. So that is a program that has been performed to make that specialized task. So that is a special purpose computer. I hope you get good understanding of these special purpose computers. So last but not least, we are having these terminologies of computer, in which we have microcomputer, mini computer, mainframe. After 5 minutes, I will take all your queries. Let me bind up with these four topics, and supercomputer. So whenever we are starting about this level, these are slow and simple, cheap and small microcomputers, and these are fast, complex, expensive, large computers. Starting from this place, move towards up, speed will keep on growing, complexity level will grow, cost will grow, and size will also grow. Means mini computer are the smallest, supercomputer are the largest one. Mini computer are the slowest, supercomputer are the fastest. Mini computer are simple, microcomputers are simple, and supercomputers are complex. These are cheap, and supercomputers are very expensive. So have a look. This is the microcomputer. Our desktop computers. These are microcomputers. So microcomputers are also known as your personal computers or PCs. They are also known as desktop computers. So these are the most common, smallest, cheaper computers. They were basically introduced in 1970 as a result of microprocessor. Firstly, microprocessor was developed, and when microprocessor was developed, this microcomputer was also developed. A single microprocessor may carry more than 1,000 of transistors. So these transistors are silicon chip devices, are the devices that are present on a microprocessor. We will have a look at the microprocessor plate also, and these parts also in the second unit. We will do this hardware part in detail in second unit. So this is microcomputer. It is a personal computer, and it can be placed on a desk also. Fine. So it's, where can we use this? What are the application or uses of microcomputer? So they are being widely accepted and used in business as well as home, as well as educational institutions. They are commonly known as personal computers and are usually single user machines, but can be interconnected among themselves from a local area network. And these are the basic types of microcomputer: desktop computer, laptop, smartphone, your tablet, your workstation, server, PDAs, palm tops. All these are devices, gaming devices, they come under the category of your microcomputers. And then we have mainframe computer. See, this is the diagram of mainframe computer. So this is not a personal computer. This don't look like a laptop. This don't look like a desktop computer. This is somewhat different. See, there are big, big racks. You can see racks over here. Multiple processors are placed in this, and screens are linked to this. There are some processors. A number of devices are available. So this is a mainframe computer. Different from your desktop computer. Now see what is a micro mainframe computer. It is a big iron, high performance computer used for large scale computing means used for complex computing device, computing we need mainframe computers. They require greater availability and security than the smaller scale machine. In the past, typical mainframe computer might have occupied 2000 to 10,000 square feet. See how much space was occupied. If we're talking about a laptop, it consumes very less space. If I talk about a desktop, it will still consume very less space. But if I'm talking about a mainframe computer, it will take 2000 to 10,000 square feet space. To put this this mainframe computer, we need this much space. But now they are being smaller in size. They are getting smaller in size, but they need very clean room. They will not tolerate dust at all. And they need fully air conditioned. A laptop can work without AC. A desktop computer can work without AC. But mainframe computer can't work without AC because a number of electronic circuits are present in that will heat up. It will produce a lot of heat and it may get damaged. So how it's working? Mainframe computers are associated with centralized rather than the distributed computing. These computers are large as well as expensive also. Thousands of users can work at the same time. Multiple users can work on the same computer. So these are the names of a few micro mainframe computers. IBM S390, it can support 50,000 users. See, on a laptop, only I can work. If I'm working on a desktop, only I can work. We 50,000 people can't work on a single desktop or single laptop. Fine, but 50,000 users can work on a single mainframe computer at the same time. You can see like this. This type of setup is available. So number of people can work at the same time on a single mainframe computer. So operating system that is being used, special operating systems are required in mainframe computer. These are the names of operating system. Linux is also supporting. You need not to go into this much details. Its users, see where can we use. Have a look at the users. They are basically used as servers on World Wide Web. Suppose if you have visited our IT department, you can see a number of racks available over there. What is the purpose of them? To provide connectivity. They are servers. So basically, you can say your servers are a category of your mainframe computers in which a number of racks and number of processors are working simultaneously. So if we say a world, we are connected with other one device is connected to other devices through World Wide Web, then this is the thing. That is, mainframe computers are specially used on servers. On the World Wide Web, the mainframe computers are used in large organizations such as banks, airlines, universities, where many people need frequent access to the same data. And these are usually organized into one or more huge databases. These are the examples: IBM S390, Control Data, Cypher 196, AMTAL 580. These are the names of a few mainframe computers. This is again diagram of mainframe computer. See, this is IBM's mainframe computer. Number of racks. This is the setup. A device screen is available. See, you can a number of racks, number of processors, so many interconnected devices are available inside these racks. This is the closed rack. And when you open this rack, you will be able to see these vast things. These are generally not present in normal computer. Fine. So I hope you are clear up to this mainframe. So now I will be taking your queries. Firstly, I will take your few queries. Then we will bind up with this lecture. So let me just give me 2 minutes.